is the Matrix.
Your mind. You must unlearn what you have learned.
Targeted individual experience. This is not a dream. This is not a dream. Welcome again. Welcome, as I've said, to a brand new video to the Target Individual Program, Target Individual Experience. Today, I am going to expand a little bit more beyond the realm of dreaminess, beyond the realm of ignorance, and to help you guys become awakened to the Matrix. Okay? I hope that was sort of dramatic. I hope. But anyway, as you guys have seen in my videos I've been posting lately because of the heavy ongoing psychological attacks, as well as the intimidation from the New York Predator Department in trying to silence me for speaking out against their illegal acts, their criminal acts of coercive persuasion program in which they engage in, and also the spreading of rumors and slanders, the use of technology to surveil, to manipulate, the use of those within the community, particularly those who have strong religious affiliations, to get them to engage in criminal act against targeted people, such as myself. Okay? And so, again, the attacks, particularly the blitz, is followed by a period of isolation. And then is where they will start now using family members as they started doing today in a much more aggressive manner, right? So the heavy tactics of the psychological operation outside is coupled with isolation. And then if you are a target living amongst family members, they will begin an aggressive form of targeting using family members within the home. Okay? But I do want to, like I said, expand on this. There was an article that I found. You know, I found this article many years ago. I think I did a video on it, and I just found it today. Okay, because again, I'm going to prove to you guys, like I always said, whatever I talk about is not just my own opinion, but is actually factual. Some of it may be my opinion, right? And my experiences, my experience, but I'm always show you guys sources and documentation to back up my claims, or what it is I'm talking about, so that you guys don't get misled, and I don't mislead you guys into, you know, certain narratives that they want me to engage in, certain talking narratives such as aliens and finding demons and all this stuff. Right? I like to keep things in the realm of reality. Okay, so which means that I use terms that are non-religious, non-supernatural, right? But legal terms, legal wording, to where you can make a case for yourself in terms of exposing what it is that's being done to you. And if you decide to take legal action, a legal recourse, you can do so with the understanding that what you are talking about, that you can back it up, right? With evidence and sources and documentation, okay? All right, so let's begin with a short overview of coercive persuasion program. And this, you can find this on the website psychologicalharassment.com. Coercive mind control tactics. Terminology note. Today, mind control and brainwashing in academia is commonly referred to as coercive persuasion, coercive psychological system, or coerced influence. The short description below comes from Dr. Margaret Singer, Professor Emeritus at the University of California, Berkeley, the acknowledged and leading authority in the world of mind control and cults. Coercion is defined by the American Heritage Dictionary as the force to act or think in a certain manner, to dominate, restrain, or control by force, to bring about by force. Coercive psychological systems are behavioral change programs which use psychological force in a coercive way to cause the learning and adaptation of an ideology or designated set of beliefs, idea, attitudes, or behavior. The essential strategy used by the operators of these programs is to systematically select, sequence, and coordinate many types of coercive influence, anxiety, and stress-producing tactics over continuous periods of time. In such a program, the subject is forced to adapt in a series of tiny, invisible steps. Each tiny step is designed to be sufficiently small so that the subject will not notice the change in themselves or identify the coercive nature of the processes being use. The subject of these tactics do not become aware of the hidden organizational purpose behind of the hidden organizational purpose of the coerced psychological program until much later, if any. These tactics are usually applied in a group setting by well-intended but deceived friends and allies of the victim. Now, I'm going to dispute that, okay? They're not well-intended, okay? It is, these programs are intended to do harm, all right? I will say that they are deceived, okay? But once they realize and see the harm that it caused, they don't stop, because at that point, they know that that harm that they cause the individual, that they could be criminally prosecuted for that, and therefore they have to keep up the charade in terms of the labeling the victim as mentally ill, right? So this is what they do. So I'm not going to go through all of this, okay? Just wanted to give you an overview of what a coercive persuasion program is. All right. Now, there are other forms of coercive persuasion program, as well as those that are coupled with other types of manipulative criminal actions against an individual, such as Zoom. And what's happening here in the United States is that you have not only coercive persuasion programming, but it is coupled with a Zoom type of program also, which is the decomposition of an individual or individuals within a society. Okay? So this comes from Chernoff narcissists, right? Zoom gaslighting. The macroism. Gaslighting is done at the microcosmic level in narcissistic families. So Suzume shows us what can happen at the macrocosmic level when narcissistic modes of behavior are institutionalized at government level. The effect on individuals is the same. What is gaslighting? Gaslighting is a form of psychological torture. It is a tool used by some people with personality disorders, generally cluster Bs. It is when one person party makes another person party doubt their perceptions of reality. The gaslighter will lie frequently, often with innocuous things, often about innocuous things. They may deny events have happened or invent events which did not happen or rewrite history to be what they idealize it to be, with themselves as either the hero or victims. Okay. At times it may be unconscious and at others conscious. It may be done within romantic relationships by a parent to a child or in the workplace. Gaslighting is destabilizing as it results in the gaslightee doubting their sanity and judgment and their own sense of reality. It is subtle abuse and it is done in the pursuit of power and control. Zertsuzum, psychological warfare. Zertsuzum is a psychological warfare technique used in East Germany in the 1970s and 80s by the state against their opponents. Zertsuzum translates into decomposition as it means to disintegrate someone. The goal was to weaken their opponent's mental health and their ability to fight against the state. The use of Zertsuzum is well documented due to files published after the dissolution of the Stasi, the Ministry of State Security, with up to 10,000 individuals estimated to have become victims. And it's actually more than that, right? I think the final tally was upwards of close to 500,000 people. Okay, the Stasi was the main security service of the German Democratic Republic, and Zertsuzum was defined in its 1985 as a method of operation by the Ministry of State Security for the efficacious struggle against subversive activity. With Zertsuzum, one can influence hostile and negative individual across different operational political activities, especially the hostile and negative aspect of their disposition and belief. So these are abandoned and changed little by little. The goal of Zertsuzum is the fragmentation, paralysis, organization, and isolation of the hostile and negative forces in order to preventatively impede the hostile and negative activities, to largely restrict or to totally avert them, and if applicable, to prepare the grounds for a political and ideological reestablishment. Directive 176 lists the following as forms of Zertsuzum: a systematic degradation of reputation, image, and prestige on the basis of true, verifiable, and discredited information, together with untrue, credible, irrefutable, and thus also discredited information. A systematic engineering of social and professional failures to undermine the self-confidence of individual, engendering of mistrust and mutual suspicion within groups. Directive number 176 of January 1976 of the development of operational procedure, beginning with intelligence obtained by espionage, The Stasi exploited personal traits and supposed character weakness of the targeted individual. Methods generally involve the disruption of the victim's private or personal life. This included gaslighting and smear campaigns, denunciation, provocation, and psychological warfare. For example, the Stasi would access the individual living quarters and leave visible traces of their presence by adding, removing, or modifying objects such as the socks in a drawer, or by altering the time that an alarm clock would set off, was set to go off. The Stasi manipulated relationships of friendship, love, marriage, and family by anonymous letters, telegrams, and telephone calls, as well as compromising photos, often altered. This was to cause family members to become alienated from each other. Children of narcissists. Children of narcissists would be familiar with the techniques of Zuzum, as they would have been used by the narcissist against them. Narcissists use gaslighting techniques which will cause havoc with their children's perception of reality, and their children will undergo punishment if they are not accepted, if they do not accept the narcissist's version of events. There will be triangulation techniques which cause division within the family and between siblings. They will run smear campaigns against their children within and outside of the family, and will often destroy their children's reputation. As threat to a person with NPD authority and control, the techniques of Zosuzum ensure that the child of a narcissist is neutralized, and therefore so is their ability to fight. It is the destruction of their personality and the construction of a new, more compliant, acceptable, fragmented, purified version. Okay? So, just wanted to read that as a target individuals understand that, you know, this is what they do, right? So, the state will label anyone who is who they consider to be a threat. Now, why are they using children of narcissists? Okay, because this is what the state label a dissident. They label the dissident as narcissistic, and therefore not only neutralize the individual, but also neutralizing their children. Because when you have a difference of belief, particularly, let's look at black people, right? Particularly those of us who are conscious, who understand the truth, and we teach our children the truth. Not only is there an effort to neutralize us as adults, conscious adults within our community, but also our children, because we are teaching our children the truth. And because they understand that our children will have a different mindset, one that's based on facts and reality and truth instead of lies, they are labeled as also children of narcissists. Okay, now there are narcissistic people out there who will definitely destroy their children's lives. That's without a doubt. Okay, but what the state does is that they will label dissident, political dissident, those who fight against injustice, those who are whistleblower. They will give them a psychiatric label, a negative psychiatric label, in order to neutralize them, to take away their voice, to discredit them, right, and to institutionalize them. So let's understand that. And so as a targeted individual, you would think that this just only happens to targeted individuals, whistleblowers, right? No. It is not. I want to bring your attention to this article. Let me, actually, this is not the article that I wanted to use. use. Let's see here. Here we go. Now, a few years ago, I came upon this story, okay, in Mad in America, which is a website that's dedicated to science, psychiatry, and social justice. And it talks about how science is used, how psychiatry is used to destroy the lives of people, okay, and to use these weapons, right, because psychiatry is used as a weapon, so is science, and in the fight against those who seek social justice and political justice. The political abuse of psychiatry in America, my story. Imagine going to the airport to travel to London, a commute you had made dozens of times before, only to find yourself locked in a high security psychiatric ward a few hours later, stunned and naked except for a gown and underwear, paralyzed by psychoactive drugs, and deprived of all of your belongings. This happened to me, and you will be shocked to learn how easily it could happen to you. The airlines and their cronies in government don't want you to know that the political abuse of psychiatry is alive and well in America. Sadly for me as a black person, I know this all too well. I mean, not being kidnapped and locked in a mental institution, but I know that the use of psychiatry have been heavily used as a weapon against black people, particularly black freedom fighters, black civil rights leaders, community leaders. The use of psychiatry by this racist system and its institutions has been a weapon that is all too well known in the black community. Okay? And the sad part about it is that within the past 30 to 40 years, what they have done is create within the black community and through religion the rapid and increase in psychiatric labeling of black people. I am a mother of two with no history of violence or arrest, but was falsely arrested and imprisoned without probable cause, notice, warrant, charges, legal advice, hearing, or paperwork for 18 days in a psychiatric ward at Zucker Hillside Hospital in New York City, part of Northwell Health, in June 2011, during which time I was drugged and subjected to various types of severe physical and emotional abuse, including assault, hands-on stripping, and deprivation of human essentials like water and fresh air. This was carried out by malicious staff, several of whom were unlicensed by the state to practice their profession. I was handcuffed, perp walked, and my car and nearly all my belongings were confiscated, including my MacBook, iPad, iPhone, pen, paper, books, toiletries, contact lens, medication, belt, clothing, jewelry, shoes, keys, and money. I was denied contact with my children, including my youngest, who was only age 7 at the time. There was no signature or approval in the hospitalization process issued by any authorized individual committee or court. This is not a picture of the New York where I was born and raised. It is a grisly reflection of the political abuse of psychiatry that took place in the Soviet Union or under or another authoritarian regime. My small-town Christian upbringing and my 2 college degree did not prepare me for this, nor did my career as a medical technology executive. I was raised in a seaside Long Island suburb where there was practically no violent crime. Even though I had traveled around the globe many times and lived on 3 continents, I had never encountered a situation as terrifying as this one. I had visited some of the most gruesome hospitals in the world on business, but never have I seen anything like this. Nothing is going to erase the psychological devastation to me from being stabbed in the back by people who owe me a duty of care, not well label me with a record of arrest and involuntary psychiatric commitment, which have been damaging to my reputation, social life, and ability to find employment, and could continue to do so for the rest of my life. I went from having homes in both London and New York to owning no property and living in my parents' basement. It was, and still is, terribly humiliating. Not well staffed, literally assaulted me twice and emotionally knocked me down so hard that it has been impossible for me to get up again. Neither Northwell nor my health insurance company, United Healthcare, informed me in advance of Northwell's usurious fees of over $67,000, that's $3,700 per day, gave me the opportunity to approve the fee, or told me how much the insurance would cover and how much it wouldn't until long after I was discharged. These fees would pay health insurance premium for two entire family for a year in New York State. They are more than twice the daily rate for a suite at a five-star hotel. My insurance company did not question these rates and paid them in full even when I asked them not to. This is astonishing given that people all over New York State are allegedly waiting for a psych ward bed. I reported my complaint to every law enforcement and regulatory entity I could think of at local, county, state, city, state, and federal levels, right up to the White House, not to mention the British government, the UN, and Interpol. So far, I've been shown almost nothing but deliberate indifference. The maze of bureaucratic fingerprinting pointing involved would take pages to explain, but there is a good explanation in my court documents. Suffice it to say that they either ignore me or point the finger of blame at some other government body. How I ended up at JFK without a passport is a long story in and of itself. If I hadn't been in the midst of a family crisis, the abuse I endured at the hospital might not have been as traumatic as it was. But I was in the throes of an ugly divorce, which was causing me unbearable depression, anxiety, and insomnia. To find some tranquility, I left my family home for my parents' house with nothing but my little boy and a suitcase. A day after I arrived, my parents' house flooded and a few belongings I had with me were soaked. I felt as though I was suffocating, so I decided to go to the UK to see my teenager, who was in boarding school there, and my friends, and I had lived in London for 11 years. It felt like home to me. There are things about my personal life that I felt I couldn't discuss with my family, and I wanted to deal with the emotional turmoil surrounding my divorce in my own way. When she learned of my plan, my mother hid my passport because she didn't want me to leave. She probably thought she was helping, but this meddlesome act infuriated me, and we exchanged some cross words about it. So I gathered up all of my other ID documents, which was more documentation than most people ever possessed in their lifetime, dropped my son at my sister's house, where he had stayed happily hundreds of times before, and drove to JFK Airport alone. I went to the British Airway terminal because I had flown BA many times, but BA staff refused to sell me a ticket without a passport and wouldn't offer me any further assistance. I started to get annoyed, although not agitated or loud, and told them I was going to call the media to the scene to document the dispute. In response, BA called the New York Port Authority police to arrest me. I had dual U.S. and U.K. citizenship, and was one of the early enrollees in the British Home Office IRIS recognition immigration system called IRIS. I should have been able to use this to enter the UK without a passport, since I had done so previously. The IRIS system, as the name implies, involves technology that can recognize the individual characteristics of the human eye, which are as unique as fingerprints, thereby eliminating the need for a passport. However, BA staff did not even stop to ask me about this before they called the police. They were in a hurry to confiscate my phone, handcuffed me, and hustled me out of the terminal before I was able to call a reporter. BA observed with indifference while the police handcuffed my wrists behind my back, without charging me, without probable cause, and without reading me the Miranda rights, then deprived me of drinking water while they waited to see to what seems an intermittent period, and transported me to the New York City ambulance in a New York City ambulance to Northwell. I expect to be greeted with kind professionals who would tell me that it had all been a mistake and that they were terribly sorry. Instead, I encountered a mammoth money-spinning machine staffed by cold, sadistic doctors and their robotic minions. These individuals admitted that I was not violent or dangerous, but saw unfit to abuse me anyway. Okay, so you guys can read the rest of this. I'm not going to read a lot of it. But there was also another case in New York City where you had a lawyer, a black woman, who was driving in her BMW, was stopped by two police officers, two white police officers, because they said that her music was too loud. And as they were writing her a ticket, she proceeded to tell them that, you know, that she's a lawyer and that Obama is one of her followers on Twitter. When she told them that, the demeanor and attitude changed. They arrested her and took her to Bellevue Hospital, where she stayed there for 2 weeks. Okay? Where the doctors, you know, forcefully giving her medication and telling her that she's not friends with Obama on Twitter. I'm not making this up. You guys can go Google it, and I should have Googled it right now, but anyway, go look it up yourself. All they had to do was check her phone, right? And they will see that, yes, Obama was following her on Twitter. But because she claimed that, and she said that, they locked it up into a mental institution. This is New York. New York City. Okay? So if you think these things don't happen, and if you're a TI and you're sharing your experience with others and they don't believe you, tell them to go look up this from Mad in America, Political Abuse of Psychiatry in America, and the article on that black lawyer who was institutionalized because she said that Obama followed her on Twitter. The abuse of authority by those in authoritative position to ruin people's lives with no repercussion, no accountability, and on top of that, they've created a cult within the religious institutions, within your neighborhood, to spread false propaganda, lies, okay, to destroy your life and to keep you under surveillance, all right? And I'm not even talking about the stuff that they do with the technology. Because that's, again, you know, I may mention some of it, but that's another whole different video, okay? All right, so analysis of gang stalking, electronic targeted assaults, psychotronic torture, and a historical perspective of oppressing minority groups. Okay, this is from medium.com. Right. To begin, I originally thought gang stalking and electronic targeted assaults and psychotronic torture were tied to the perpetrators' possession of strong essential beliefs in a common culture, for it is to be classified as a phenomenon that displays characteristic possessions of strong essentialist belief. The person would have to believe in upholding the principle that are here to teaching practical skills and knowledge to young children, shaping self-discipline and responsibility within a mainstream common culture. But the very act of gang stalking, electronic targeted assaults, and psychotronic torture combined with other elements of electronic harassment deviate from essentialist principle in that perpetrators of these crimes seek to alleviate themselves from responsibility by veiling their identity through strategic tactics. In fact, its behavior is more closely rooted in the psychotic foreclosure of splitting that becomes part of the cycle of violence often observed in patterns of domestic violence and domestic abuse, male batterers. Torturing people with low-level ELF, electronic low frequency, is not helping someone. It is harming the individual because of its tedious, bothersome intrusion, which seeks to passive, aggressively nudge the individual towards sickness and an untimely death. The sequelae of gang stalking, electronic targeted assaults, and psychotronic torture are not fully understood yet, but it has been established through independent research studies to be connected to post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, and anxiety. Similar to how new pharmaceutical drug therapies side effects are poorly understood, the full sequelae of side effects haven't been officially documented. As with new pharmaceutical drugs, new advanced technology can also pose potential harmful side effects. Doctors prescribe pharma drugs to patients when they believe the benefit of taking the drugs will far outweigh any possible harmful side effect. In this light, it would appear gang stalking, electronic targeted assaults, and psychotronic torture may be part of some type of unethical, inhumane medical research study or connection with clandestine military experiments utilizing control over subjects. Well, I got used to you. It is all of those and then some. Okay? Essentialist principle encouraged traditionally common culture, and therefore anything that may lie outside of traditional common culture would be considered deviant. It's the difference between the conservative Republicans and the liberal Democrats. To make an even more fundamental comparison, we could illustrate the fundamental differences between white culture versus black culture. Compare the differences in popular music genre in both groups and comparing the differences in popular visual art in both groups. These are some of the basic differences between young white Americans and young black Americans. Each individual upholds some level of essentialist belief. Some score high while others score much later. Strong essentialist belief are associated with certain groups like the Marines or uncorrupt police officers who uphold principle of honor, courage, and commitment. These types of principles of leadership strongly support community ties and the regulating of behavior by adhering to family values and core principles of leadership. Leadership principles that exemplify the ultimate in ethical and moral behavior. Never lie, never cheat or steal. Abide by the uncompromising code of integrity. Respect human dignity and respect others. Honor compels people to act responsibly, fulfill their obligations, and hold themselves and others accountable for every action. Those that score much lower in essentialist belief may be associated with minority groups that deviate from traditional common culture core value of leadership. Now, I understand what the author is trying to say here, and she's absolutely right. We are living in a culture that is dominated by white people, right? We always hear them say this is a white society. And the fact that black people within white society have constructed their own society, though too many of them, of us, are trying to go into, get into, or be accepted by white society, which will never happen. But how white society, the dominant society, view black people is at a much lower level, less intelligent, you know, less moral, right? Whereas white society is considered to be more moral, more intelligent, which we know is not true. We know within cultures, within people, you have people who are highly intelligent, who are not so intelligent, who are so-called, or believe that they're highly moral, while judging others to be highly immoral, okay? So, again, when you look at targeted individuals and those that participate in are targeted, be it family members or those within the society and the community, they think of themselves as being a higher moral authority. But what the reality shows is that they are the deviants within the society, within the culture, not the people who they are targeting. Okay? So, historically, over 70 years ago, the stereotypes of traditional mainstream common culture in America was presented to the public as the white suburban family. Husband, wife, two children, living in a middle-class suburban housing development, wearing traditional conservative clothing, owning a moderate automobile, with a father holding middle management job. To illustrate social differences, this stereotype starkly opposes the radical group known as the hippies that were popular during the 1960s. And with the formation of this alternative lifestyle, as with the formation of any alternative lifestyle, we witness the manifestation that of social conflict. Differences between majority groups and minority groups contribute to civil unrest, political process for social rights that oftentimes turn violent. Vietnam War protests and the Black social rights movement express the difference in opinion between the two groups. Radical groups are commonly defined based on the differences in their lifestyle choices, value system, and social practices that deviate from mainstream common culture. Extraordinarily, groups like the Gypsies, the Mormons, and the Old Order Amish are some groups that, although may not be considered deviant, lie outside the traditional America common culture. Group difference are what generates fear and isolation, and it is usually through segregation by the larger majority seeking to isolate the opposing minority grounds and blocking them from gaining any form of social momentum, power, or leverage within the mainstream social order. This cannot be said of the Old Order Amish, who actively isolate themselves from the larger majority based on their religious belief. But we see how human homogeneous tendencies isolate and protect the integrity of the group. This basic philosophical principle is what I believe is contributing to the phenomenon of the targeted individual suffering electronic targeted assaults and psychotronic torture. ELF is the use of low frequency, which can accomplish a form of electronic targeted assault and torture. Imagine receiving low-level frequency stimulation vibration to your dental implant that is unconsented and unannounced as you go through your routine. Mild vibrational energy to the headaches that can create mild form of discomfort and fatigue. Electronic stimulation vibration in the lower back and spine, giving the subject a sensation of a garland types of discomfort and bothersome annoyance that creates a dystopic existence in an individual life. Roman levels of moving electronic stimulation that move throughout the entire body is another aspect of electronic targeted assaults that contributes to the onset of depression, anxiety symptoms, and post-traumatic stress disorder. being awakened in the early morning hours when it is suddenly turned off, both in your head and at other times in the lower body. Aim at making the individual feel extremely uncomfortable. Then the person trying to offset the discomfort by eating or by anesthetizing themselves by drinking alcohol contributes to the long-term sequelae of electronic targeted assaults and psychotronic torture. Targeted individual claim to hear voices, and some of these voices talk and answer them. This is one of the most insidious aspects of the targeting, because the symptoms get labeled schizophrenic by medical doctors, because the actual reason as to how this technology accomplished what is accomplished remain vague and poorly understood. Gang stalking, electronic target assaults, and psychotronic torture is a bloodless crime. In reviewing other forms of phenomenon, catheter mutilation, where various forms of livestock are killed and then mutilated by organ removal, catheter mutilation at first glance doesn't appear to be bloodless crime, but it does possess a form of bloodlessness. A very common report in cases of catheter mutilation is the draining of blood from the animal, followed by organ harvesting. In any case, people victimized by this form of crime report no blood splatter or blood spill at the crime scene. And since we can only understand the meaning behind its silent articulation, I ask myself, what are the symbols of bloodless bloodshed? All right, so I'm not going to continue reading all of this. You guys can read this yourself. This is from medium.com. Okay, you guys can Google the title. And, you know, what a strange analogy, but I see what she's saying, right? Our crime is, I would not say bloodless, because some TIs, or target individuals, have headaches, which can lead to nosebleed. You're hit with these sort of weapons, right? Now you can become dizzy, fall down, injure yourself, you know, cut yourself. So I wouldn't say it's bloodless, but I get what you're saying. It's not a direct physical assault of someone punching you, assaulting you with a weapon, which causes you to bleed. Okay, I understand that. This is just a weird analogy. But, you know, the reason why I read this, again, this is from another TI. And it's important. This is important, you know, and we all have our voices and we all want to be heard. Okay, so if I can do my part of sharing information of another TI, their experience, what they go through, as long as it's been in written and spoken in a context that dies in the realm of reality, which means you're not talking about religion, you know, supernatural possessions and all that stuff. Okay? You want to hear me talk about this stuff. I may reference stuff like this in terms of the narrative and what they want you to believe, right? So you can sound like what they label you as, right? So they can continue to get away with it. Okay, and so I want to thank this individual, Karen Banner, for writing this, and though it was written in 2021, but I want to thank all TIs, all whistleblowers, for their courage, for their absolute resolve, for their moral value, their love of humanity, and the absolute hatred of government corruption and wrongdoing. Okay? All right. Well, listen, there's going to be a part two of this video. Don't want it to go over an hour. I just wanted to read these things because, you know, what I'm going to be talking about next is the narcissistic personality trait of those that are in a position of power, right? Those who have the dark triad personality traits, right? Which is akin to those types of personalities seeking out positions of power so they can commit acts of violence, crimes against humanity, and therefore they can get away with it because they can change the rules, they can label anyone, they can engage in illegal, unlawful, horrendous activities and crimes against the general public and get away with it. All right, so stay tuned for part two.